All right, let's talk about the actual components or what makes up a synovial joint. And there is a lot of connective tissue in this region, and we need to talk about what we find in all synovial joints and then some specialized things that you see in more complicated synovial joints. So let's start with what we're going to have in all of them. And the most important component is what actually is binding the bones, the articular capsule. So what's on the edge of either side of the bone. So this is what's actually uniting them. This is what's enclosing that synovial cavity within. Now there's two layers to your articular capsule. You'll have your fibrous layer. Anytime, and this is going to be your outer layer. Almost always when we're talking about anatomy, anytime you have an outer layer, that's typically the more robust, the protector of the layers. And that's exactly true here. This is going to be composed of more dense connective tissue, only allowing for certain things to get into the cavity. The inner portion, so in this region right here, is your synovial membrane. And this secretes synovial fluid. So if you ever think about why you do warm-up before an exercise, is to get that synovial fluid a little less viscous, allowing for your joints to move smoother. So we'll talk a bit more about fluid in a moment. Also, we have articular cartilage, so that's actually on the ends of bone. Key here, what I want you to take away from this is not actually binding the bone. This is only there in case the bones actually do contact one another in order to absorb that shock and not allow for that pain that would occur on bone-to-bone contact. So reducing friction, absorbing shock. It is avascular though, so anytime you have anything avascular, typically doesn't heal well or may not heal at all. So that's why you have a lot of the surgeries associated with articular cartilage replacement. That synovial cavity is going to be the space between articulating bones. And I have space here because typically it's almost just a little pocket. Sometimes there's little space whatsoever. So this is obviously a schematic. It's not ever really this large, but it does allow for movement. If you think about the different types of movement that can occur, say at your elbow joint, that space allows for the bone to move into different areas. Now that synovial membrane of the capsule is going to secrete synovial fluid. This is going to be totally within that synovial cavity region, and it's going to line almost all components except for the articular cartilage. So it's lining all components except for that hyaline cartilage. Important in terms of reducing friction, absorbing shock, similar to that articular cartilage. But also it includes phagocytic cells, so it can actually eat up anything that's in there that shouldn't be. Also, it supplies nutrients to that articular cartilage. So even though you don't actually have blood supply going to the cartilage, you can get oxygen from the synovial fluid there. So everything that we just discussed, those are going to be components of all synovial joints. Let's talk about a few specializations that are going to be in some. Articular discs are going to be composed of fibrocartilage, and this actually is going to divide the synovial cavity. And you can see in this illustration, typically they're not very big. This is the mandible. It's going to be articulating with your temporal bone. So think about what joint that would be. Temporal, mandible, temporomandibular joint, so your TMJ joint. You're going to have this fibrocartilage or this disc right in the middle of that joint, and it allows for that joint to be divided into two separate spaces. And that's really important in terms of allowing two different types of movement to occur at the TMJ. So obviously the one we think about, opening and closing, and also you can jut out your chin, protrusion, and then retrusion back. So we'll talk a little bit more about the specifics of the articular discs, but generally it's going to be associated with two complex and very different movements. Meniscus or menisci is the plural. You're going to find these in more complicated joints as well, and particularly joints where you have a very shallow articulation. So this is showing you a superior view of the tibia, and this area right here, this is your articular cartilage. This is very shallow. Now, what's going to sit on top of that is the distal portion of your femur. So this is where you have the formation of your knee joint. And if you think about that, that's not really going to provide a very good fit. So you have these additional fibrocartilaginous discs, which are different than the articular discs we just discussed because they are incomplete. Okay, so they're not forming a complete circle. So generally, they're almost crescent shape. And what it's doing is kind of extending that area and allowing for a better fit between the two bones. So improvement of fit, it redistributes weight, and also it's going to play a role in terms of facilitation of combined movements. So you'll see these a lot in hinge joints, but a lot of times hinge joints aren't true hinge joints. You can have a little movement to the lateral and medial sides as well. Very similar to the menisci is what is referred to as a labrum. And these are exclusive to ball and socket joints, so your shoulder joint and your hip joint. And what it is just an extension of the connective tissue that kind of forms a little lip to allow for a better fit of this ball portion. So in this case, when we're looking at the shoulder, the ball would be the humeral portion, allowing for it to fit better into the socket, or in this case, the scapula. Now, bursae are not actually a true component of a synovial joint, but they're very often associated with synovial joints. And what these are little connective tissue sacs that are very similar to joint capsules. They'll have a little bit of fluid in them, and you'll find these in areas where there's a great deal of friction. So, we don't have this in the actual illustration, but in case of the shoulder joint, you're going to have a bursa here, you're going to have a bursa here. Oh, you can actually see a little bit of it there. You'll have a bursa here. So in areas where you have quite a bit of movement. If you've ever heard of the term bursitis, that's the inflammation of a bursa. So you'll see these in areas that are more complex joints, in areas where you have more complex movements. Also, you'll have them associated with what's referred to as tendon sheaths. Tendon sheaths are just a specialization of bursa, so very long bursa. And these, the best example of those are going to be in your wrist region. You have these very long tendons. They're going to the joints at the distal end of your hand. So you have these tendons that are going to be covered by these tendon sheaths that are going to allow you to be able to flex your wrist and flex your digits without a lot of pain. So those are a few examples, specifics in terms of structures that you'll have in more complicated joints. We'll talk about the specifics at specific joints such as the shoulder in a little bit more detail in subsequent modules.